Greetings.
My name is Joshua Bynus, and I'm the Industry Foresight Lead within the Corporate Strategy Organization at the Bonneville Power Administration. The following presentation is part 7 of a 7-part video series focused on exploring the long-term electric power industry landscape. If you haven't already, please take a few minutes to view the introduction to the series for some valuable context. Hopefully, you'll find the time spent viewing this video to be valuable. Please feel free to send me an email with any feedback. Enjoy. Non-hydro resources will become increasingly competitive in the Northwest. Here, we've been talking about the competitiveness of renewables quite a bit already. We're expecting natural gas to remain pretty low cost, but ultimately, we expect to see a slight increase in its costs over time as we see more generators getting built that are supplied by natural gas and expansion of exports from the United States to other countries in natural gas. But even with that aside, renewables are competing already with those low gas prices as they stand. And so as an example here, we can look at wind. And these are power purchase agreements from 2014 through 2017 and show how they compare against those natural gas prices. And you can see they're comparing quite well against them and expected to do very well over time. One of the things that's driving the low prices for wind is the fact that as the manufacturing has been scaling up, so has the size of the turbines themselves and the towers that they're associated with. And so, you know, they're literally scaling up, getting larger and larger, taller all the time, and the rotors are getting larger. And as they're getting taller, they're able to reach up into more steady winds, so that the rotors can be spinning more frequently. And the turbine designs are actually getting improved as well, so that they can continue spinning at higher wind speeds and at lower wind speeds as well. And so the production capacity of these wind generators has been improving quite a bit, to the point where some of the newest stuff that's coming out on the market right now in the windiest zones on the planet, like in the American Midwest, are coming in closer to about a 60% generating capacity profile, or in some places in Europe, in the same thing. What's really starting to get to be a limiting factor on these is that they're getting so big that they're hard to haul around and get into place. And manufacturers have actually had to create new technologies just to transport them so you can turn a corner with these on the back of the truck. Costs have been falling pretty steadily, and you can see from the power purchase agreements since around 2010, the costs have been coming down. You can see these green circles are a lot of wind power purchase agreements in the American West. They're higher than some of these others, but a lot of the purple are in the interior of the country where the best wind is as well. But there's a lot of technologies out there, whether you're talking about on land or offshore, anchored or floating offshore, where in each of those technology classes, they're going through a steady round of advancements, and everyone's expecting that the cost of those wind turbines is going to continue to fall. Some of these companies, organizations like Sandia, are looking to scale up offshore turbines. They're hoping to get a 50-megawatt turbine constructed. There's some concern that the turbine blades could be so big that in a strong gust of wind, it could strike the tower and take the tower down. So they're designing those so that they can fold up during a really heavy wind. Other companies like Vestas are experimenting with new designs that they can leverage to use less steel, less wire, maybe fewer inverters. The idea is to use less land and just do all these things to help drop the cost so that they can still maintain a high degree of competitiveness moving forward. When we look at kind of what's happening in the offshore space, there's some different wind turbine designs for these floating offshore turbines. And that's been a real limiting factor for the advancement of offshore wind off the West Coast because the ocean's so deep. We are starting to see some interest now in some offshore wind in British Columbia. And we're also seeing some interest in some offshore wind off the coast of California as well. And we'll see how that develops over time. One of the trends we're also seeing, and this is reported from Green Tech Media, is that the agreements for these offshore turbine acquisitions are showing more and more interest in the really big turbines. And so I think we can expect to see that trend continue as well. When we look at solar, we were I was talking about solar prices already earlier in a previous chapter. Solar is already competing well against natural gas, and over time, it's expected to increase its competitive pressure against gas. As we look at the impact that the manufacturing scale-up has had, you know, every time the world's solar power doubles, the cost of those panels falls by another 26%. So there's a corollary to Moore's law in regard to the processing power of computers to manufacturing scale-up and solar here. And one of the things that's driving that is the higher efficiency of the panels themselves, and I'll come back to this in a few minutes. And so, you know, as the efficiency of conversion of sunlight to electricity improves, then those panels need to be smaller to create the same amount of power. That means less metal, less rare earth materials, you know, just less material in general, less land, and it helps drive that cost down. At a certain point, that downward cost advantage gets to be a bit de minimis. But I think we're going to see advantages stemming from increases in efficiency for quite a number of years. Here you can see, you know, this dotted line here at 16% is because, you know, majority of what we see getting put out there in the environment, especially like in California right now, has been going in around 14 to 16%. So there's a lot of room for improvement on efficiency. For years in the Northwest, we used to hear from naysayers about solar that, oh, it's too cloudy in the Northwest. You'll never get solar here. I'm not a believer in that. And, you know, here you look at, you know, some of the mapping of the solar quality, the radiance quality. And, you know, this map at the top shows a mapping of capacity factor for fixed tilt. These are panels that are in that southern tilt of 25 degrees and a fixed orientation for their entire lifetime. And in that situation, yeah, the Southwest looks great. The Northwest has got a lot of green, doesn't look really so good. You know, the reality is in the Northwest that all of the utility scale systems that I've seen go in for a year or more now have all come in with single axis tracking systems on them. And that means that they have a tracking system that will follow the sun from the time it comes up in the morning across the sky and down to the horizon again. And once you add those single axis trackers onto your system, all of a sudden, the Northwest is looking really good for solar. So when you hear people tell you that solar will never come to the Northwest because it's just too cloudy, I would just encourage you to just not believe that and just kind of let it go in one ear and out the other. When you compare the Northwest to Germany, who certainly hasn't had trouble going solar over the last decade, the irradiance quality of the Northwest looks way better than Germany. And, you know, when you look upstream in the R&D space in solar, a few things start to really stand out. And this is maintained by NREL. You could think of a lot of the changes that are happening in the electric power industry. And you can think of solar being the tip of the spear that's forcing a lot of those changes through. But when I look up the R&D pipeline, and this is just one kind of summation view of some of it from an efficiency perspective, it becomes pretty clear after a little while that we've only seen the tip of the tip emerge when it comes to all the changes that we're likely to see coming from solar advancing into this industry. And what I mean to say is we've seen crystalline silicon panels really hit the environment. That's about 90% of the international market in solar PV is held by crystalline silicon panels. That's the majority of everything we see. Like I said earlier, the efficiency rating of what we've seen built in the last 5+ years, most of that's come in around a 14 to 16% efficiency rating. In the labs, we're seeing some of the efficiency ratings getting as high as 27% for that technology. That's the blue here. And there's still lots of room for improvement. There are some folks out there that think that the theoretical maximum efficiency that crystalline silicon can achieve is around 30%. So it's starting to butt up against that. But there are other advancements that come along that kind of push that boundary out a little bit further. I'll come back to that in a minute. Now, there's other classes of solar technology out there as well that we really have not seen kind of explode into the marketplace yet. And one of those is the green here, and that's thin film. And thin film, until just a couple years ago, was cheaper than crystalline silicon. It's only in the last 2-3 years that crystalline silicon really overtook it in its price competitiveness. And part of that just has to do with the fact that crystalline silicon has gone through a much more effective manufacturing scale up. The market's really taken off in combination with some of these technological advancements to have a more efficient panel that's smaller. Thin film, though, has some real advantages. It can produce power in an environment of diffused light, typically better than a crystalline silicon panel. It's moldable to the facade of a building, and it can deal with shade or broken sunlight without breaking the circuitry to make it stop producing power. You know, I feel like once the efficiency ratings of the thin film can improve to the point where it's at a good price point, you don't need quite as much land or square footage to produce the same amount of power. And we could see that start to show up in the built environment in a way that we just have not really seen in mass yet, where we could see it on the sides of buildings. We might even see thin film get some advantage out of manufacturing scale up in its inclusion in electric vehicle design, where it could be incorporated for range extension. And similarly, if the trade action that is kind of underway right now and ready to be announced by the Trump administration comes through and they penalize Chinese-based crystalline silicon panels and drive the price up of those, it should help the competitiveness of thin film as well. So that's going to be a whole new future that we see develop when we see the built environment more infused with solar technologies like thin film. Now, beyond that, the magenta technology class up here are multi-junction cells. Those are the kind that we use in our space program now. We used to use crystalline silicon in our space program, but those have been overtaken by the multi-junction cells for that functionality. And these are, you know, think of a kind of layered solar panel where each layer can derive power from a different spectrum of light. And so, you know, for those, you get efficiency ratings in the lab now as high as 46%. Not really seeing these getting commercialized yet in the non-space environment. I heard some rumblings of maybe 6 months or a year ago of a company that was thinking about doing it, but I haven't seen anything since then. But I think at a certain point, the cost of these will get to a point where we'll start to see these also showing up in non-space environments to be used. And then, you know, besides that, in the red category down here are the emerging PV technologies. And I'll just highlight one in particular, and it's this one here, and it's the perovskites track. And you can see just in a short amount of years how they're racing up the efficiency gains here. Perovskites they're kind of like the graphene of the solar industry. It's just this amazing material. It's very low cost. It should be able to like contribute to kind of reel-to-reel manufacturing capabilities. It's got some problems that they're trying to work out in the labs right now. Ironically, it doesn't like being in sunlight or water, so it degrades quickly, but they're finding ways to protect it so that it can last longer. It's also got some reliance on lead, and so they've got to find ways to liberate it from its reliance on the lead. But there's some analysts out there that are looking at different ways that we could see perovskites enter into the production chains of even crystalline silicon, maybe some hybridization of those to help crystalline silicon break through its 30% efficiency threshold maximum. So we'll see. It's one of those advancements that there's a lot of R&D news on fairly constantly, and so a lot of attention being paid to it. Point being, when you look out over time, over decades of span in this space and solar power, there's still a lot yet to come that we have not really seen emerge yet. Now, lastly, you know, when we look at comparison of some of these renewable technologies compared to especially legacy technologies that have already gone through their technology curves, what we see is that as the technologies advance on some of these new renewables, their costs are dropping. As they go through their manufacturing scale-up, their costs are dropping. And they're competing very well against the legacy technologies that have been producing power for decades. And so expect that to continue. If I have to leave everybody with kind of a final takeaway here, it's just that we're at a point of time in our industry where no matter what direction you're looking in, there's change coming from just about every direction. And if your organization is standing still and not responding to this change, it's essentially the same as moving backwards. So I encourage everyone to kind of embrace the changes, look up, see what's coming as best you can, with the reality that all of these forecasts that I've shown you are probably all wrong to some degree. But I think what's the most important is that we embrace the reality that things are changing and do what we can to be flexible to those changes and try to find solutions for how we maintain a reliable grid for all stakeholders at cost competitive prices. And if anyone has any questions, please go ahead and write me. My email's right on the front page there, jdbinus@bpa.gov. I'd be happy to answer your questions. If you have any interest in having me come join you and your team for a discussion about this, or you'd like this presentation live, just let me know and we can work something out. Thanks for watching.